Okay.
Mr. Labat, you have the floor.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning, people in America, people in Asia, people in Europe. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening to everyone. This is Hugo Labat speaking from Buenos Aires, Argentina. And I have the immense pleasure to share with you this session of the forum that is named Positioning the Role of Curriculum in the Transformation of Education in the Post-Pandemic Era. I want to thank the International Bureau of Education and his director, Mr. Yao Ido, University of Malaya, that is one of the organizers of this event, and also APROSE and APRAXI, two organizations that have helped to build up this momentum for having this seminar. We are trying to discuss in this forum several participants who can give us their impressions on how the university can be a tool to improve the transformation of education in this post-pandemic era. I just will make a very short remarks on the meaning of this forum and propose some guiding questions that all our presenters will discuss from their point of view. And then we are going to have a close-up session led by Mr. Renato Perti, who is already here. And so first of all, I will try to discuss the role of universities in the transformation of education. Universities, as you all know, are a place of thought, are a place of understanding, but also are a place of invention, a place of research. So we hope that all universities are partners in the process of transforming education for the coming future. But now this process has been much speeded up by the pandemics. The pandemics has invited us to make use of our creativity, of our new ideas, to make the process of sharing and the process of learning more complex and based on the available technologies. So the post-pandemic era also has led us to a new way of doing things by collaborating, by sharing the experience, because we have been submitted to a very stressful situation at the global level. And so we have learned to collaborate a lot, and this forum is all about collaboration. We are trying to exchange new ideas. And so the main point that this forum will address is the role of the specific role of curriculum in transforming education. So we are asking our colleagues in the different universities, how are they working with the curriculum aspect? How are they doing research? How are they doing training? How are they doing invention in terms to promote the development of curriculum specialists all over the world? And how are they helping the education systems to increase their capacity in these challenging times? So without further introduction, I'd like to invite Professor, let me see, Professor Hamdi Abdelaziz. Professor Hamdi Abdelaziz is professor of distance learning. He is the Dean of the School of E-Education in the Hamdan bin Mohammed Smart University in the UAE. He is professor of curriculum and instructional design in the Tanta University of Egypt. So we are very happy to introduce Professor Abdelaziz, and he will discuss with us in his presentation, in short presentation for 7 minutes. I will make him a signal when we are arriving to the 7 minutes time frame. So most welcome, Professor Abdelaziz.
Good evening. I hope you are able to hear me, Mr. Ogo.
Very well.
Is there any echo on my sounds or so?
Yeah.
All right. Thank you very much for this short introduction. It's my pleasure to be with you, my colleagues, from around the world. It's a great opportunity. Thank you for UNESCO and IBE and the University of Malaysia for giving us this, you know, event to come together for the sake of, you know, reimagining the curriculum around the world. I represent Hamdan bin Mohammed Smart University. It's a small university stated at the United Arab Emirates, especially in Dubai. You know, the age of this university is much, you know, like say that it's less than 15 years old. However, it has a great impact in the Arab world and the MENA region, especially. I'm very proud to present in my university and to share some ideas with you or projects or actions that we are working on right now or we had working in the last or previous year. For Hamdan bin Mohammed Smart University, actually, we have two comparative advantages. We always say that it's linked to our, you know, mission and the vision, the future goal as well. We are focusing on quality management and smart learning. So I'm focusing the other, you know, in the second, the comparative advantage, would say, which is the smart learning. So I'm representing this dimension in my university. Actually, in the previous year, recently, I think in the last 2 years, Hamdan Mohammed Smart University has, you know, initiated a global initiatives in terms of, you know, how to bring the teachers around the world together, especially during the COVID-19. We launched two crash courses in this regard, collaboratively with, you know, some institution, Ministry of Higher Education here in United Arab Emirates, and it is adopted now by an International Institute for Technology and Education. It's an UNESCO, you know, organization. And these two courses has made a great impact. For example, from around the world, you know, we have seen like more than 300,000 of teachers and educators who is taking care of online teaching and learning. They registered and they take these two courses. Out of these 300,000 teachers around the world, there was like 150,000 certificates, so who completed these two courses, which is very important to bring a teacher around the world together. We had some challenge in this regard, to be honest with you, in terms of the language. So we had to translate these two courses, two crash courses, into five different languages. You know, English, French, Spanish, and the Russian university as well, to attract as much as we could from the teacher and educators around the world. I think we are making a good progress in this regard. These two courses are free courses without any fees and open for all to take. It is a step-by-step guide how to, you know, be an online tutor in less than 24 hours and how to design online courses in less than 24 hours. This is very important for teachers around the world since it gives them a skill-based set to produce online courses and be able to deliver these courses through your educational context, whether pre-university level or at university level. The second initiative, in fact, which is very important and related to this, you know, initiatives that we had established, you know, an international committee that's taking care of producing or developing international benchmark for open and smart learning. This, you know, bring, you know, some institution from Asia, from Europe, from Commonwealth of Learning, UNESCO, as a world organization, and, you know, some other partner around the world, which is very important because our practices were not depending on some framework internationally. When it comes to that increasing demand on the online learning, we had to have, or we have to have, some sort of benchmark, international benchmark. So we are working this right now. We will launch this initiative soon by, you know, asking other universities around the world to be a partner with us so that they can benefit from this platform in the future. Because it's all about quality. When you speak about online learning, how to think about the trust of online learning without having what is called international benchmark in this regard. I hope you will be able to share this information with UNESCO IBE and UNESCO Teacher Task Force as well, and any other partner around the world, and later on, inshallah, by the end of this year or next year. This will facilitate, you know, working together based on well-known benchmark in this regard. The third initiative that I'm very proud to be the manager of this initiative since I joined this university in 2016 is the postgraduate program in curriculum design and development, which was, you know, established and launched collaboratively with International Bureau of Education. They gave us a full support in this regard. We were able to train almost like 80 teachers and educators from MENA region to take this postgraduate diploma in curriculum design development, which responded to the UNESCO mission in this regard and IB mission as well. So these 80 teachers were taken or were selected from the Arab countries. We have like 22 Arab countries in our region here. So at this diploma, and we had like 16 Arab countries representative by participant in this diploma. Now we are very proud that to follow up our graduate from this diploma, they are making some, you know, outstanding change. So innovative and the change management curriculum, they are starting, you know, deploying and implementing personalized learning design technology in their, you know, local area, which is very important. They at least now they can look at best practices around the world, benefit from this practice and try to apply them based on what we provided to them in this diploma. I think for in the future, because of the impact of this diploma, there is a great recommendation from the UNESCO and the HBSU together to upgrade this diploma to be master in smart curriculum and learning. We are working this right now, and in the near future, we'll hear good news with regard to the accreditation of this program to be used to enlighten all Arabic teachers, educators, school principals, and other, interested group in the MENA region to, so that they can lead the innovation change management through smart technology, especially when it comes to their local curriculum and any educational policies that are related to curriculum development. The last initiatives, which is very important, I will take 1 minute only, it's, you know, how to link this university and what we provide here with African continent. So we launched last year a kind of initiatives and a big project to help the African university and the schools to be able to use our resources, especially innovation change management programs and entrepreneurship. This is very important to have a young entrepreneur around the African continent. The idea is, you know, to have our sources available to this university in Africa and the school in general so that we can come up with a new generation who's able to lead their country or projects in the future. This is skill-based learning and the free resources available for the African and schools and university, which is very important. But the challenge that we are facing now, how to enlarge this based on, you know, the language factor, because Africa has more than, like, I can say, 5 major languages in Africa. So we are trying to deal with this situation in the future by the support and the help from UNESCO and the other interested group in this regard. I hope I got my 7 minutes in the right direction. I would like to thank you, Mr. Hoju, in this regard, and I will be very glad to listen to other colleagues in the initiatives and projects so that we can get together in the future to enlarge and, you know, make a notive, innovative collaboration in this regard. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Hadi. It has been a great set of ideas. I will underline just a couple words. International access, quality, how to increase capacity, and the possibility of doing collaboration across institutions. I thank you very much for your presentation. And now I will give the floor to Professor Pamba Dieng. Professor Pamba Dieng teaches organizational theory, steering and management of educational systems and structures, and educational research methodology. He is a deputy director of the Educational Systems Research Laboratory and director of the Institute of Educational Science. This is an UNESCO chair. And he is working currently at the Faculty of Science and Technology of Education and Training of the Sheikh Anta Diop University of Dakar. So most welcome to Professor Pamba Dieng. The floor is yours.
Merci beaucoup. J'espère que vous m'entendez.
Oui.
OK. Donc, merci beaucoup. Merci vraiment de cette initiative et merci aussi pour l'honneur que vous nous faites de nous associer à cette manifestation. À la suite donc de ce qui a été présenté, nous, ici au niveau de l'Université Cheikh Anta Diop, plus particulièrement de notre faculté, face à cette situation de pandémie, nous avons profité d'un dispositif et d'une expérience qui a été menée depuis un certain temps. Vous n'êtes pas peut-être sans savoir qu'avec le plan des objectifs du millénaire pour le développement, nos pays avaient eu à recruter beaucoup d'enseignants qui n'avaient pas nécessairement les formations professionnelles requises et qui enseignaient. Et donc, face à cette situation, pour relever la qualité de l'encadrement, il avait été question de mettre en place des dispositifs pour les former, ce qui était déjà une situation de crise pour nous. Et à partir de ce moment, l'initiative qui a été développée, c'était de mettre en place des formations bimodales, essentiellement à distance, mais avec des temps de regroupement. Et c'est cette pratique qui nous a permis de pouvoir, face à la situation pandémique que nous avons connue, d'impacter sur le système éducatif au Sénégal. Parce que beaucoup d'enseignants, vraiment, c'est autour de 6 000 à 7 000 enseignants, sur 4 à 5 ans, ont eu cette pratique de formation à distance, ont été eux-mêmes formés à distance. Et à partir de ce moment, ils ont pu eux-mêmes dupliquer assez facilement et donc impacter sur le système. Et c'est cette expérience que nous avons un peu renforcée en accompagnant via notre corps professoral le système éducatif dans la révision des programmes pour voir vers quoi il fallait aller pendant cette période de pandémie, qu'est-ce qui pouvait être fait à distance, comment il pouvait le faire, alléger peut-être certains aspects du programme, insister plus sur le développement de capacités, de compétences et élaguer certains aspects de contenu purement livresque, donc juste des connaissances théoriques, et qui ont permis donc au système de pouvoir redémarrer après un temps d'arrêt relativement long. Et l'autre initiative qui a été développée au niveau de notre université, c'était aussi donc de renforcer les capacités des acteurs, aussi bien en termes de compétences techniques, aussi en termes d'appui pour la mise en place de dispositifs d'enseignement à distance. Nous avons toute une pratique dans ce domaine-là, avec des compétences des facultés qui forment sur ces questions et qui ont été donc investies pour accompagner le système. Il y a un certain nombre de questions, naturellement, qui se sont posées, surtout quand il a fallu revoir les programmes, les curricula de formation sur des périodes relativement courtes et qui nous ont amenés aussi à nous intéresser davantage à ces questions de formation autour du curriculum. On avait des modules de formation là-dessus et ce qui nous amène aujourd'hui à nous positionner pour vraiment mieux structurer cette formation et en faire un programme de master sur la conception, le développement, l'évaluation des curricula de formation et les questions connexes au curricula. C'est un peu ces aspects que nous avons eu à développer et qui aujourd'hui fait qu'il y a un certain nombre de pays limitrophes du Sénégal et même un peu plus éloignés qui ont décidé de nous envoyer des cadres de leur système éducatif pour qu'ils puissent avoir donc des voyages d'études, des sessions de partage sur ces expériences-là que nous avons eu à mener avec, dans le cadre donc, de la pandémie au Sénégal. Et c'est vraiment pour aussi rebondir sur ce que disait tout à l'heure le collègue de la Smart University, ces aspects de partenariat qui nous intéressent particulièrement et nous avons eu à partager aussi avec eux dans le cadre de la mise en place donc, de ce master sur la conception, le développement et l'évaluation des curricula. Pour ne pas trop tirer sur la parole, c'est un peu ces aspects que je voulais présenter. Merci.
Okay, so thank you very much, Professor Dieng. I would like to underline the need to review the teachers' training in curriculum, and also the possibility of doing it in a collaborative way, and the offer of a structured proposal. This is a very interesting thing because sometimes the learning in curriculum is like a kind of professional development that takes a different courses for different people, and having a structured opportunities is a good thing to do. So thank you for your collaboration. And now we are inviting Professor Dilma Bijekiene. I hope I pronounced it correctly. She is the Vice Rector for Communication of the Vytautas Magnus University in Lithuania. Dilma Bijekiene is the Vice Rector, Lithuania, sorry. And he's Associated Professor at the VMU Institute of Foreign Languages. She has received her BA and MA in Linguistics in Lithuania and in the USA, and she has done her PhD at the University of Bergen, Norway. Her research is focusing mainly on gender and linguistic indirectness in the British parliamentary discourse. So, Vilma, most welcome, and the floor is yours.
Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, and in Lithuanian, that would be Labai Diena. And I'm really very proud and happy to be in this honorable company together with you. And I'm very grateful to UNESCO IBE for organizing such a wonderful plenary event. And extending the greetings from Lithuania, I would also like to say some words about our university, Vytautas Magnus University, the small university based on liberal arts approach, and very much focused on internationalization. We have 15% of international students coming from around the whole world. And we are very proud to cooperate with UNESCO in our educational management study program that is very popular. And we this year we have accepted 90 students to the program, again, coming from different countries of the world. So that is really a wonderful result. Vytautas Magnus University, with its education academy, actually has experts who are regularly invited to participate in the working groups and different commissions of the Ministry of Education, Science and Sports of the Republic of Lithuania and the National Education Agency of Lithuania. We have currently 7 experts who are working in the field of competence descriptions for compulsory education, dealing with cognitive, cultural, communicative, citizenship, emotional, and other competences. And we have around 20 experts contributing to curriculum development for compulsory education, and that includes curricula for ethics, history, natural sciences, languages, and other fields. Our university actually covers basically a wide variety of fields, from humanities to arts to social sciences, technologies, natural sciences, and even up to agricultural sciences. Our experts also participate in discussions on curriculum development initiated by different national associations and culture institutes. As a representative of the field of linguistics, I can bring an example from my personal involvement in the discussions organized by the French Institute, Goethe Institute for German, or Lithuanian Language Teachers Association, on teaching foreign languages, on content and language integrated learning, and international baccalaureate or other relevant fields. I really need to accentuate that enormous value is added to curriculum development by extensive European networking and cooperation. The best example would be the Erasmus program, which was initiated by the European Commission in 1987. And for example, to bring some numbers, in 2019, over 3 billion euros were spent on Erasmus mobility and different other projects. Nowadays, Erasmus Plus entails three main key action programs. Key action one for student, teacher, researcher, and other staff mobility. Key action two for developing strategic partnerships. Key action three for offering innovations for government policy reforms. And I would like to bring one example of our university's participation, namely LISTIAC project that unites nine European universities from Finland, Lithuania, Belgium, Slovenia, Spain, France, and Portugal, and also three ministries of education from Finland, Slovenia, and Portugal. So in that project, we have an international team that consists of university experts and policymakers to work together on developing a linguistically sensitive teaching approach for general education. And this linguistically sensitive teaching is extremely important as a tool for inclusive education that has become especially acute in Europe nowadays, with the influx of migration and the need of adjusting to multilingual and multicultural classrooms. I also want to accentuate the European Language Council, and I'm a member of the board in the council. It is a network of for universities. And for example, for Vytautas Magnus University, this membership helped to develop the university language policy. And at our university, we have very strong focus on teaching languages. We offer around 30 languages to all university community and to the public. Now, the latest worldwide initiative for universities is the initiative of European University Alliances. 2 years ago, our university joined Transform for Europe Alliance together with other six universities from Estonia, Bulgaria, Poland, Germany, Italy, and Spain, with the primary aim of cooperating for innovation in the development of students' entrepreneurial skills, linguistic skills, citizenship skills, for implementing green agenda, and for joining resources to cooperate in double degree study programs. So basically, these are the main moments that I wanted to accentuate along the lines of cooperation with the government and also the cooperation at European level. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Vilma. I'd like to highlight from this presentation the idea of cooperation between universities and the ministries of education. This is a very important way to help to use the knowledge produced by research and at the university levels with the practical action at the ministries of education. And also, I'd like to highlight the issue of inter-university collaboration for joint projects. This is a current trend, and we hope that this is going to be extended in the future. So thank you very much. I'd like now to give the floor to Professor Teresia Shabika. She is a professor at the Open University of Tanzania. Mrs. Teresia Shabika received the Diploma of Education from the Teachers College in Tanzania, which qualified her to teach secondary schools. At the University of Dar es Salaam, Tanzania, she received her Bachelor of Arts with Education and a Master in Applied Social Psychology. And the Doctorate of Philosophy in Developmental Psychology at the Utrecht University in the Netherlands. And she has taught in Tanzanian secondary schools for 12 years. And now she has joined the Open University of Tanzania, where she's working today. So welcome, Professor Teresia, and the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Yeah, thank you for inviting me on board. Maybe I should correct you. I'm not a professor. Do you hear me? I'm a senior. I'm just a senior lecturer. Yes. Our university has been participating in an disseminating curriculum through teaching. As I said, that is the main work of the university in my introduction, as teaching, research, and consultants. And through teaching, we have, of course, our curriculum we are insisting on competence-based and skill. But we have been in collaboration with the other institutions. For example, we have a curriculum which under the we are saying curriculum design and development, that is a master program which we are collaborating with UNESCO and the IBE. And I know we are going to have a meeting maybe shortly after a few minutes. So we have been collaborating through under UNESCO that we should have a curriculum which cut across which should be international. And at the moment, we have a work of reviewing the module which we teach in collaboration with UNESCO. That is the most important which we are doing. But we are saying that our university is unique in this country because our mode of delivery is through online. And through online mode of delivery, we are saying that we can reach other people beyond Tanzania. So we are not much encouraging face-to-face. We are encouraging online, but we are saying that it's blended. It's too early to run to face-to-to online because of some problems and challenges. So we teach face-to-face, we meet sometimes, but online is the most important. And we have other students from other countries, even for students who are from Francophone, we have them. Of course, because in Tanzania also we have, of course, not many people who are competent in French, but they are helping us even through translating and things like that. But we are saying that we are moving, we want to globalize the curriculum. But the problem which we have, there are several problems. Although we have that mode of delivery, which we find is very friendly, which can reach anybody, anywhere. But as we are looking at the university, we find that people are not much interested, as students, not much interested on online studies, especially the young one. They are very interested on conventional universities, so that is they sit in the class, they go in the dormitories, which in the open university, we don't have that. So that is the main important, but we have few, we are still encouraging them to continue doing that. But maybe before I go there, we find that ours, we are teaching through practice. We encourage learning by doing. And learning by doing, we find that most of the programs which are taught in the Open University are being practiced in the real field. And that is the most important because we find that our students gain experience, they become innovative, and through a competency-based curriculum. Having said that, but also let me point out that the challenges, as I said, most of students would like to have a degree, but not skills. So one would be very much happy to have a degree than having skills. But in our university, we are encouraging that everybody should have skills. That is the meaning of competence-based curriculum. Skills is what matter, and not just content you learn. You have a degree, which is not does not qualify you to do anything. Other issue is technological advancement. We know that our country is very big, and as we are going to online, the technology is highly needed. So we find that there are some issues due to shortage of technology. We are still lagging behind, but we are looking forward that everything will be clear in future. So ours and our online is highly encouraged, of course, by the government, especially this period COVID, the COVID-19, and is where only the Open University has not closed due to COVID, because we were teaching our students through online. So our curriculum is very, very friendly in that way. Oh, yeah, thank you. Maybe the time, if I can continue, I don't know. Do you hear me?
Yes, quite correctly. Thank you very much, Professor Teresia. In case we are going to do a short round of questions after each of you has done a presentations, and we'll come back to some ideas. I'd like to underline from the presentation the idea of skill development at the level of university students is very important, and especially when you are doing training for curriculum professionals, the development of skills is quite essential. And also I'd like to make a point on the structure of the Open University, that from a long time ago has allowed to reach out to participants from not only from Tanzania but also from other countries in the region. So thank you very much, Professor Teresia. And now I'm giving the floor to Camila Gottlieb. Camila Gottlieb is an associate professor from the Catholic University of Uruguay. She has a master in learning, technology and education from the University of Nottingham in the UK. And she's associate professor at the educational department here in the University, Catholic University in Uruguay. She is currently the director of Master in Learning and Curriculum, and also a pedagogical consultant at the Postgraduate School of the University. And she is a consultant for UNICEF Uruguay. So good morning, Camila, for you in Montevideo, and the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Hugo. Can you hear me right?
Yes.
Yeah, great. Thank you very much. For me, it is an honor to be here with you. Thank you very much, IBE UNESCO, and thank you to the organizers. And thank you very much for my other colleagues in this panel. It is a pleasure to listen to you, and I'm sure there is plenty of opportunities to learn among each other and also to collaborate internationally. There is a number of initiatives that I would like to highlight from OKU that implies curriculum and rethinking education. And I would like to begin sharing some information and some key facts about our master program in curriculum and learning. It began as a diploma on curriculum design and development in partnership with IBU UNESCO. 7 years ago, and it has impacted more than 300 students from at least 12 countries in Latin America and the Caribbean. They are mainly professionals that are working at their Ministry of Education or at a national level, or different levels also at a school level. And this diploma has evolved on a master program that we are very happy to hold at UKU. We are currently having five, it's very international. We are having students from five countries in Latin America, and it is taught in Spanish and also in French, as we have students from IT, and the Spanish ones are Bolivia, Guatemala, Colombia and Uruguay as well. The idea is to professionalize the field in curriculum, and we are also providing some methodological tools to the decision making. So as other panelists were saying, this connection with the Ministry of Education and the teacher training, this is a program that tries to connect these two worlds, like the research and also the professional level and a public policy theme. The modality, it is blended long before the COVID-19 pandemic has arisen. Students meet in Uruguay for 2 weeks, and then they continue to work remotely through platforms, and they work very collaboratively. And another initiative that I would like to highlight that is very important, and it has resulted very successful here in our university, is the master program in active methodologies for learning. Active methodologies for learning, it is a master program that teachers are taking, and it was designed also a little bit before the COVID-19 pandemic began in Uruguay and around the world. But there are some many teachers taking this master program, as it has innovative approaches to education and through different courses, such as learning based on competencies, learning based on teams, on projects, cooperative learning, educational technologies, inclusion and diversity. They cover a lot of competencies that are needed for the educational of tomorrow. So this is an initiative that we are very proud at UCU. And of course, it is, the modality is totally virtually. So it has allowed, enabled students from around the country to participate. And this is a very good point, as they don't need to come to the capital of Uruguay to study. So we are having teachers from other parts of the country that their educational offer is quite limited. To finish, another initiative that we would like to share with you, Aruku, it is a project, it is not confirmed, but last April we applied to hold a UNESCO chair on UCU on hybrid education. It has been a proposal that we also integrate many international institutions and other universities, some are part of this forum. And it will be the first chair on hybrid education in the region and also internationally. Although we don't have the resolution, we are very, very interested in working on these topics and working internationally and collaboratively with other partners in the region, as hybrid education is what we think it's coming to stay, and how to enhance curriculum on a digital level, blended teacher learning assessment, it has all changed. So we would like to take the step forward and to lead that initiative. So we are very happy, and we will see what happens. And just to finish my presentation, I would like to say that also at the university, we have some professors, and in Uruguay, they are currently developing a transformation of the curricula, especially on secondary education. And some of our professors were consulted by the government for their advice. And for us, that is very interesting, and it makes us very proud that our work is being considered at the transformation of the public education. Thank you very much.
Thank you to you, Camila. And I'd like to highlight a couple of points here. First, the idea of using blended strategies, and that they are here to stay, This is a thing that we should reflect because it has an impact on how higher education does its business. And but also it has impacts in learning and in the compulsory education. And reaching to teachers to discuss the methodologies that they are needed to improve their teaching in this new context is very important. So thank you very much for that. And I'd like to invite now Professor Lydia Fung. She is the Dean of the Faculty of Education, Languages and Psychology in SEGi University. Professor Lydia Fung has 30 years of experience in education settings locally and in the UK. She received her baccalaureate in education with honors from the University of Greenwich, as a master in educational management and PhD in education from the University of Malaya. She is currently the Dean of the Faculty of Education, Languages and Psychology, and she is the director of the Confucius Institute at the SEGi University. So Lydia, welcome, and let's hear from your side. The floor is yours.
Thank you, Hugo. Many thanks to UNESCO IBE for organizing this forum. If you look at the screen at the back with the plant, I'm very pleased to inform you that actually that is the design from our in-house designer. When we organized the conference, as you may be aware, we are the host for the curriculum Asia Pacific Conference on Curriculum Studies and Instructional Design 2021. In collaboration with University of Malaya, UNESCO IBE, Asia Pacific Research Association of Curriculum Studies and Instructional Designing, as well as the Association of Professionals in Curriculum and Education Instruction Malaysia. So this is actually one of the great achievements that I would like to share with you, because all this was done during the pandemic, when most of the staff are, facing lockdown, they can't go to work. They are mostly working from home. In between, we might be allowed to office, but you know, when the lockdown happens, we gather again, online. And also, the meetings are held very regularly with all our partners, also virtually. It's a very interesting experience that words can't express. And also, in fact, the meeting tonight. So thank you very much, my sincere appreciation. What I want to share is SEGi University is a comprehensive university. We have programs ranging from education, of course, where we come from. We have been doing teacher training from the 80s. We have engineering program, we have medicine, and so on. So we also have international students from 80 countries. The theme of the conference that was set was on sustainable environmental and social economic development, inclusive education, and sustainable quality education, which are the themes that are very close to our hearts, particularly in teacher education. But of course, we have many other disciplines as well of professionals and experts in the university. As many of the colleagues have said, the COVID-19 pandemic has brought about an unprecedented impact to education, particularly when we were in the lockdown. Universities were closed and we were not allowed to deliver face-to-face delivery lessons. So we returned to online learning instead. Now online is, it's something that we are very familiar with, but 1.5 years ago, we were really lost. So I would like to share with you something that, we have used, we had set a strategic direction before the pandemic, which was what we call the IR 4.0 initiatives. So the tagline that we use, that we followed closely was, at that time, we wanted to reimagine in the context of IR 4.0, recognize, redefine, and revolutionize. And we find it so useful during the lockdown, and I would like to share with you from each of the areas. Reimagining education. In the early stages, we spent endless hours observing and exploring, trying to find ways, new ways of working, reimagine possibilities that could help us achieve our objectives in teaching and learning and other cultural and engagement activities. So in recognizing, we realized that, when we were doing things, you know, in a very comfortable way in our comfort zone, we realized we limited the options, for example, recognizing the potentials of our stakeholders and industry players, because most of the time we are very comfortable in our own zone, but, how to engage them to make an impact in the community. For example, the government, the industry, the schools, the community, the NGOs, and so on. This is a classic example of, collaboration and the power of technology that could link people together, the connection that we could make. And in fact, during the pandemic, we found that we run more webinars that we use, that we run, during the, pre-pandemic era. So it's really amazing. And, our webinars grew from 50 people to 100 people to 300 people. And now this this conference that we are holding now actually have 600 participants that are registered participants from 5 continents except Antarctica. So we're really proud. And, of course, we must thank all our partners for bringing people together. Coming to talking about reflecting on redefining how we redefine the new opportunities that come along the way, definitely there are problems like how to encounter, like for example, this platform that we want to use for 600 people, we have tried many ways, many suppliers, many technological models. Finally, we decided we will go with Zoom because, that's the friendliest, I think, and most economical and, more accessible to many people. So these are some of the considerations that we have to make. In terms of students and staff, we need to constantly inspire them to redefine teaching and learning, because they face problem every single day when they teach. And I know that because I look at the WhatsApp messages and, I know that. And challenging the status quo. And we also need to understand that a change is a core part of everyday business, and we need to adapt so that, what we do is sustainable, for our staff and the students. So we have to change the way we work. And, the chair has rightly said that the pandemic has fast-tracked our IR 4.0 aspirations. Because we now have to teach online, you don't have a choice. You need to deliver the resources that are required, because we used to have hard copy books. Of course, we have, limited e-resources. Now we have turned most of the resources online to e-resources. We also have to conduct online assessment. That was challenging. It was a big job how to do it, effectively. And many staff, surprisingly, embraced online delivery, and conduct the online examinations and hold online forums now quite easily. So we are very pleased with that. But we also face challenges help students to learn to be an active learner, because many of them possibly you know, if they are in the classroom, traditional classroom, they could probably sit at the back and hide. But now, how to motivate them in an online environment? In the first place, how to encourage them to turn on the cameras, to connect with us? You know, the lecturers also find it difficult because they are like speaking to names and not faces. So can we eliminate lectures? You know, we produce bite-sized, videos, but are they really interested? And how to keep them motivated to learn many, many videos, because they take many subjects and there are loads of videos for them to watch before the class. So those are some of the challenges. And of course, the lecturers. Upskilling is needed. Rethinking of the pedagogical approaches are needed. Do we do blended learning, online learning, self-paced learning, hybrid learning? So many things to think about. And also the learning approaches for different categories of students based on the needs, very important, because full-time, part-time and adult learners all have different needs. In the pipeline, we will be introducing courses and programs with sustainability in mind, and with more tweak of technology. In a sense, we already have trained our students on Google Classroom and taking the Google certification. So we are looking at more competencies and skills to equip the students and the staff. We also want them to do some actionable research, because the pandemic has taught us a very important lesson on sustainability. And we really want to, make sure that the student carry that away when they graduate, because it cuts across many different disciplines. So, and we are also planning to drop Masters of Education program with a major on curriculum and instructional design for sustainable development as well. So in the post-pandemic world, a new technology is going to revolutionize everything we do. So we need to be really prepared, and we really need to see if those are really what the students need before we start designing. So that's really important. So we welcome research. So our research will be really focusing on strategies post-pandemic. So we welcome research collaboration as well with different communities. So, and also construction of contextualized online and interactive learning, teaching and learning resources is really important. I'm not sure if I think I've passed time. Sorry.
Don't worry, Lydia. Thank you very much for your interesting suggestions. I'd like to highlight one issue that you made that I think it's quite interesting, the issue of sustainability. We have tried many things during these pandemic times, but not all the things that we have tried will be sustainable in the long run. So this is a good question to reflect upon. And also the idea that the universities have to stretch a bit out of their comfort zone, trying to do new things in this new context. I think this means to do some experimenting, some trial and error, and learn from what's from the experience. So thank you very much. And now I would like to give the floor to Professor Yotsoui Saifa. He is the assistant professor in the Department of Curriculum and Instruction. His specialty areas include curriculum design for kindergartners and elementary school children. He also serves as associate dean in the Faculty of Education in Chulalongkorn Longkorn University in Thailand. So Yotsoui, most welcome, and the floor is yours for the next 7 minutes.
Thank you so much, and hello everyone. So my perspective to be shared in this webinar will be, we emphasize on basic education level. So Thailand has currently implemented standard-based approach as its national curriculum. So the school curriculum of many primary and secondary schools throughout the country quite relies on standard of the national curriculum. So in practicality, most teachers would ensure that their students would attain learning contents and achieve all learning standards successfully. So as they experience the pandemic, they end up with that school closures. So learning and instructions were supposed to rapidly switch into online materials. But unfortunately, not all Thai students, especially the one who live in the rural areas, cannot access online lessons due to their lack of technological devices and internet access. So the teachers need to find another way to deliver the lesson. And they mostly use a teaching strategies to be called on-hand lessons, like providing a self-studies package to students rather than giving them like the online lessons. So however, these situations was not what the teachers have been trained before. So although the Ministry of Education here in Thailand has lessened, simplified its national curriculum through distinguishing the standard, and they're trying to identify the required learning standard and optional learning standards for school to select to complete their lessons, the teachers still need to adjust their practices a lot, so that their teaching practices and curriculum implementations would be smoothly delivered to their students with most satisfactory. So definitely, as they are not equipped or trained before about this, these teachers really need help. So especially how to handle the lessons under the school closures. We as a Faculty of Education, Kuala Lumpur University, we actually have conduct research studies to suggest possible practices about curriculum and lesson delivery to students, especially the one who live with the difficulty situations and with like have a problem in for accessing the online material. So as well as possible policy that could apply at any level of education here in Thailand. So especially way to empower students to learning through various sources such as learning distance television program, and ways to promote strengthen student learning skills, such as like self-control, self-regulations, inquiry skills, or so we would like to make sure that they will become like a lifelong learner. So because we have no idea that we're gonna stay with the pandemic situation like this for how long, you know? So how, and we are trying to making them to become like what we call like autonomous learners, as much as we can based on our the research finding that we trying to like change the paradigm to be for the instructions here. So also we have suggested studies focusing on the concept of competency-based curriculums to lessen studying huge content areas and change to develop students' abilities to do something meaningfully. Especially under the pandemic. So we think that development of students' skills or ability would much more beneficial than teaching the content or teaching to the test. So we also have provide like a virtual training programs to a number of in-service teachers to work how to implement curriculum and lessons to students, especially how to simplify the lessons with the above mentioned limitations. So one of our services provide for the schools during the pandemic, and it does impact the school level, is an online professional development program that we call EDU co-working. So this platform is like a place where we set up a weekly program sharing successful practices and solutions from a variety of case studies. So we often share some connections between those practices and the learning theory, so that we would like to ensure that the teachers or the participants could make sense about theory to practice for online or like a remote learning to the students. So the program also allow the teachers to pose the questions and to share their thoughts, and what we rapidly respond to whatever they pose. So the topic will change weekly so that we could ensure that practices of educational levels and learning areas must be covered perfectly. So EDU co-working has been launched for a year, and the program is to continue up until now. So most of the Thai teachers get used to the implementations of standard-based curriculums, and they often strictly attach their practices to the learning standard. So therefore, we think that teachers' flexibility and decision-making become a necessary skills for the teachers, especially the in-service one, because they have to conduct the practices successfully, especially making decisions to work the selections of appropriate practices Selections of curriculum delivery strategies that make individual students get learned is very crucial. So we would like to make sure that the teachers make decisions for the right one. So besides well understanding what to teach, the teacher need to bring the lessons to the students with any kind of difficulties or limitations. So the EDU co-working programs highlight strategies for teachers to be flexible as much as they can and provide a number of choices or solutions for them to select appropriately so that they could possibly alter the curriculum implementation successfully under the pandemic. For example, we share interesting practices, how to individualize lessons to each student, as well as activities and assessment methods. So how to minimize students' workload or assignments by using integrated curriculum through making some connections between the lessons, the assignment, into what relate to students at home. So we have known that the integrations of the lessons is very helpful to students' learning, since it helps them making much more sense the lesson perfectly. And this is also very easy for the teachers to assess students' learning through the tasks that have been done by the students instead of using the paper pencil test only for assessment purpose. So the most challenging for us is the time. Although we have been conducted many research studies to synthesize and to propose practices to be suggested for the schools and the teachers, we realize that the limitations of the time make a huge challenging for us to suggest our practices to be based on research findings. So, but we're still doing our job anyway. All right, thank you.
Thank you very much, Yotsawi, for your presentation. We have given a first round of ideas. And now I'd like to highlight from your presentation the idea of flexibility, the lesson of flexibility, that we need to implement curriculum in a flexible way just to be able to tackle this kind of disruptions that we find in this time of COVID-19. And also a very important point that I like very much is the idea of self-regulation in learning. We were much used to learning in structured settings, but now learning at home means that we need to understand how students self-regulate when learning, as it is a very important capacity for learning along all along their lives. So thank you very much for that. And I'd like to ask all of you to discuss just in a very short intervention by each of you, what kind of research do you think is needed to improve the relationship between curriculum and learning in these current times? So I will put the question again. What kind of research could do the universities to improve the relationship between curriculum and learning? We can use the order that you find more appropriate. We have not to speak all in the first order. So if just one of you wants to start reflecting on very briefly, 1 minute or so, what kind of research do we need at the level of the universities? So who wants to share? Andy.
Yeah, thank you, Hugo. It was very interesting to, you know, see this international exercise about toward, you know, curriculum for sustainable development. I think we need to link the research with the curriculum with a focus on sustainable development by preparing a generation who is scalable to invade the future through innovative solutions. So if we are about to speak about the future research, we would like to invest more in skill-based learning and link this skill-based learning with the future of sustainable development in worldwide, not only in some region like this. So it's international perspective. The second thing, I think we need to reimagine the innovative, you know, pedagogies that we are using in higher education so that we can look at the smart content smart delivery mode whatsoever, smart assessment, that serve the concept of skill-based learning. This is the focus of the research. And I will be very happy to establish what's called the virtual research team from this nice, intelligent and the brilliant mind to start this initiative through UNESCO IBE or any other partner around the world. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Hamdi. What have our other panelists to say? Who would like to comment on that? Promising avenues for research. Yes, Theresia, floor is to you.
Yeah, thank you very much. Yeah, I think research should focus much on competence-based to teach students on competence, which will help to instill skills. And this will be an investment for lifelong learning and sustainable development. So this should be coupled also by training teachers on competence-based curriculum. If this can be done, it means teachers will be aware and will be able to teach our students for innovation. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Theresia. Who's next?
Excuse me, may I?
Dilma, come on.
All right, thank you. Thank you. I also think that we need to really think about the research that brings, that enlightens our teacher education innovations so that our teachers could actually be prepared for the changing circumstances, especially in the post-pandemic situation. I support the idea that was brought by one of the plenary speakers focusing on flexibility. And I think that we need to really empower our teachers to flexibly react to the changing situation and the digital competences that are necessary for the teachers. We also need research on the preparedness of schools. Again, we have different situations and schools are very much varied in terms of their facilities and how well they're equipped for online and blended learning. So again, the research here is also very much necessary. And I think that we also need to attend to the changing linguistic and cultural landscape of different societies so that we do not miss on inclusive opportunities for children. That is also very important. Again, thinking about the European context, but I think that's important everywhere around. So thank you.
Thank you, Vilma. I have Professor Bambading who is wanting to share. So we are open the floor for him.
Merci beaucoup, merci. Je pense, en fait, en termes de recherche, je crois qu'en tout cas, si je pars de l'expérience que j'ai du Sénégal et de pays africains que j'ai eu à, sur lesquels j'ai eu à travailler, un des problèmes que nous avons, c'est la capacité à anticiper sur les besoins de formation, pas seulement les besoins numériques. Très souvent, on va nous dire que oui, il y a un problème d'adaptation entre ce qui est proposé comme curriculum de formation, comme curriculaire de formation, et les réalités du terrain, les besoins du marché de l'emploi, les besoins de la société. Mais si on se rend compte aussi que, en fait, l'acte éducatif, ses effets sont toujours différés dans le temps, si nous n'avons pas une bonne capacité de prospective, une bonne capacité de pouvoir, en fait, avoir des outils qui nous permettent d'anticiper sur les besoins de la société, et se dire, l'apprenant que j'ai aujourd'hui, qui va sortir dans un temps plus long, dans 5 ans, dans... à quel monde il sera confronté et que je puisse le préparer à ce monde-là, j'ai l'impression que les curriculums que nous proposerons seront toujours en décalage par rapport aux besoins au moment où les gens vont devoir s'insérer dans la société. Et je crois que nous devons aussi développer des stratégies de recherche pour mieux en tout cas développer des outils et des dispositifs pour pouvoir anticiper sur ces besoins-là et pouvoir y répondre, tout en répondant bien sûr aussi aux besoins présents par des stratégies de formation continue, etc. Merci beaucoup.
Thank you very much, Professor Ding. We have been discussing with many of the colleagues here the need for prospective and future studies. This is an area where we should be working more. So now I have Camila Gottlieb who wants to share.
Thank you very much, Hugo. Just to add some other ideas, I totally agree with my colleagues. It is for sure that we have to develop curriculums ready for uncertainty. And I think the pandemic has shown us that this is something that we really need to work on. And another idea, I think it is research on personalized learning, how to bring other students into the systems and how to reach every single student. And also I would like to say that the research that we do in our universities should inform the public policy. I mean, we have to bring evidence so politicians and policymakers can develop public policy based on evidence that we develop on our universities. Thank you very much.
So thank you to you, Camila. And now Yotsawi is with his hand raised, so open the floor to you.
Okay, thank you so much. So I would like to be the one that agree with the concept of competency-based curriculum. So the situations of pandemic show that the people who knowing like much content, but it's useless. So comparing to knowing, having like abilities to do something, especially like life skills or health literacy, things like that. So the first thing that we would like to know that once the curriculum has been changed to be competency-based, instructions and assessment needs to be like adjusted as well, so that there would be like a system in the direction and in the same directions. Otherwise, the learner cannot be like developed with a complete competency. And the second one, the part of the research can be fulfilled. This issue is that each certain context we require like different type of competency. So for example, like Thailand, we have like a certain context, we have like some specialty area that we have to be concerned of, right? So conducting a research studies can help us to finalize so what kinds of competency to be taught and to be like delivered to our students via like a curriculum implementation. So that's my point. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Yotsawi. And now we have last but not least, Lydia Fung with who has her hand raised. So welcome, Lydia.
Okay. I believe curriculum needs to be reviewed, obviously, with the, panel of industry experts, those who are working in the industry to find the needs, the emerging needs, so that this program will be in tandem with the needs of the learners. As well as focusing on the learner-centered mode of education and assessment strategies. Also, I would like to highlight as well the importance of community-focused partnership and collaboration in our training programs, in our university programs. So therefore, researching on what is relevant and effective for the stakeholders are really important now. But the pandemic has pushed the universities to rapidly deploy digital automation and artificial intelligence technologies in education and dramatically accelerating the efforts that were unfolding at a much slower pace before the pandemic. But remote working, online classes, digital systems are changes that will really affect many people. of course, the lecturers, the students, the teachers, and the learners that may persist even after the pandemic recedes, but although may not be at the same level of intensity, not sure after the crisis, but technology definitely promises big benefits in terms of accessibility, efficiency, and innovation, but and there could be virtual cycles of growth as well in jobs and productivity, but really the research also should look at the rising inequality among the learners and the upskilling needs and mental health of the academic staff in order to mitigate unwanted negative effects post-pandemic. I think that's my view.
Okay, thank you very much. It has been a very enlightening session. I think that we have discussed a lot, and I have made some notes on this promising agenda for research in the universities, trying to explore the needs and to do things differently, because the pandemic has given us the opportunity. It's like breaking a mirror. We used to see ourselves in the mirror, but now the mirror is broken and we can see the education system and the practices of teaching and learning under a new light. So I'd like to invite to reflect on what we have been sharing to Renato Aperti and to do the wrap up of this session. So thank you very much to our speakers, to our panelists, and most welcome, Renato. You have to switch your mic.
Thank you so much, Hugo. Thank you so much, dear colleagues. It has been fantastic to listen to all of you. We are really very, very happy of this event, that we can gather people from different regions, from different affiliations, from different perspectives to get together, to get going a global conversation on curriculum. That's the whole idea of this conference and this forum. So we are very happy that this is happening. So let me I just try to, maybe I'm not doing justice to everything that's been said, but I like to wrap up in seven main ideas that have been discussing today. Maybe there are the other ones, but I'd like to mention that ones. First, this issue that we are giving new significance to some key concepts and ideas: partnerships, collaboration, experimentation, transformation, production at all levels of the system, at the institutional level, at the level of the learners, at the level of the teachers. We are giving new substance, a new prominence, a new perspective to these ideas of collaboration, experimentation, transformation, partnerships. That's the first point there. And that implies renewed ways of thinking and renewed ways of doing, as Hugo has mentioned several times. The second point I'd like to mention is that we are in a scenario where we are diversifying the repertoire of training and teachers' professional modalities. We are enlarging our repertoire of training. And we are enlarging that because we are moving towards hybrid modes of education, hybrid modes of training, because we are putting much more emphasis on the skill developments, on the competency development of learners and teachers as well. We are putting much more emphasis on this idea of democratizing learning opportunities. We are putting much more emphasis on learning by doing, on active learning, on bringing in different case studies. So in a way or another, we are expanding our training. And as we are expanding our training modalities and our training approaches, we are democratizing education, because we are democratizing learning opportunities for everyone. That's really good news for our countries, for our regions, for our communities. The third idea that was very clearly mentioned is about mobility, internationalization, internalized perspective, mobilizing people, mobilizing teachers, mobilizing students. Was the example of Erasmus in Europe. That's a fantastic experience. And this is done within region and across region. This idea of mobilizing people, teachers, learners, getting knowledge productive, knowledge sharing, well, no barriers, no boundaries. The fourth idea is that has been clearly mentioned, the understanding of curriculum today. Transformative, futuristic, sustainable, flexible curriculum. We are changing our way of understanding curriculum. We are putting together the idea of transformation, the idea of futuristic forward-looking perspective, the idea of sustainability, and crucially, some ideas about, as Candice has mentioned, of smart learning, of multilingualism, of language diversity, that's a key issue for us, and inclusiveness. So in a way or another, we are here, we've listened a lot of things that be very optimistic about the way we are reimagining education and reimagining curriculum for the future. And that's good news in terms of democratization of education, in terms of inclusiveness, in terms of language diversity, in terms of flexibility, in terms of enlarging the scope and understanding of curriculum. Issue number five, that's been very clearly mentioned, is about the professionalization and empowerment of a new generation of curriculum leaders and developers in the world. We have the great opportunity and also the great responsibility of forming the new generation of curriculum leaders that will make a difference in the sustainability of the planet, in the sustainability of education, and more crucially, in educating the new generations. So we are in the moment very critical in our planet that we are having laying the foundation for a new generation of curriculum mindsets, of curriculum leaders, developers, specialists, at all levels of the education system. Issue number six is about something that's been very clearly mentioned, the recreation, the redefinition of teaching and learning in terms of process and practices. We are redefining teaching and learning, and we are also redefining assessment. And that implies the challenge of how students can be active, engaged learners. This idea that was very clearly mentioned about learners has been long life, active, engaged learners. And what Hugo has mentioned at the end about self-regulation of learners. We are coming to a scenario where we are having much more emphasis on activity, on active learning, on active learners, on engaged learners, on learners that take responsibility for their learners and can self-regulate their learners, and that they can be able to connect, and that was very important, from the teacher's perspective, connecting pieces. Because we all know that the world that's facing now is not about silos, about discipline silos. It's about connecting pieces to resolve problems. So this idea of connecting disciplinary pieces, connecting disciplinary approaches to ensure that we provide an opportunity to every learner was very critically mentioned. And I believe that we are opening to new ways of redefining the process of teaching, the process of learning, and the process of assessment. And finally, was what Hugo mentioned as the second question, that was a critical one, about an agenda of research. How we connect research to curriculum development processes, and how we use research as a tool to have a very transformative futuristic curricula. And it was fantastic to listen to, I just sum up some of the issues that you mentioned about areas of research, teacher education, professional development, innovative approaches, innovative pedagogical approaches, putting again the idea that when we are talking about curriculum, we are also talking about pedagogical approaches. We cannot disconnect curriculum discussion from pedagogical approaches, as we cannot disconnect curriculum from assessment, as we cannot disconnect teachers from learners. The second area, it was very clearly mentioned, competency-based developments, skill-based learning. Some countries talk about skills, other ones talk about competency, but we are talking essentially about empowering the capacity of teachers and learners at the end of the day. So this idea of competency-based, skill-based learning, also related to personalization of education, personalization of learning, personalization of assessment. The other issue for agenda, for a research agenda, is about preparedness of school, how school has prepared to deliver on this new scenario. Are school willing to overcome this idea that only inside, or are school open to more engaged relations with communities, with families, bringing in online as part of the dimension of a school? The other one was about language and inclusiveness. I think that there is a critical issue that for our director at IBE is very important, Mr. Ido, that is how we can ensure that language diversity is captured in our curriculum development process. How language diversity is a tool for inclusion and not a tool for exclusion. So languages in a plural sense and inclusiveness. The other issue was about the capacity to anticipate the future. I mean, we have to anticipate the future, the prospective dimension. But anticipating the future is also taking into account that we are uncertain, that our future is not predictable. It's too complex because we all know, for example, there is an UNESCO study that showed that 60-65% of students are now in our schools are going to work in activities, in tax, in occupation that doesn't exist today. How we prepare for the future, how we have a futuristic curricula, how we anticipate that future, how we understand that future is also very important. And the last three issues I'd like to mention was very clearly also highlighted, the impact of research, evidence-based in public policies. We have to make a difference in public policy. We have to make a difference in how policies are constructed, are developed, and assessed. So research as impacting the development of public policy. The other issue was about community-based learning and partnerships. One of the effects of the pandemic that has opened us to new ways of understanding the relation between families, communities, schools. So working and deepen on this analysis of community-based learnings, a school has community resources, as community assets. And finally, this idea of technology, how can the digital component can be a labor of change, can be an agent of change, how technology will change the curricula. Not because the curricula is going to be technological based, but that curricula will incorporate a technological component to democratize opportunities of learning, because that's what it's important. So a renewed way of understanding technologies in a plural sense, because we have the old and the new technology. So Hugo and dear colleagues, I think that these issues capture some of the main debates that were taking place today. Really happy to listen to you. Thank you so much. Back to you, Hugo.
So I'd like to thank all our participants. There have been some questions that were discussed privately with some of our participants. I'd like to end this session by highlighting the idea that universities are a force for change. Universities are a source of learning and understanding. It's like having an eye that can look at the society and from this point of view, produce new knowledge and help our community to develop. So the role of universities in discussions and in sharing with the political authorities is very important. The practical side is not just producing knowledge, but also producing actionable knowledge, knowledge that can be turned into action, is a second point that is very important for keeping in mind. And I'm very happy that we have made to share and discuss seven universities from very distant parts of the world with different kinds of problems, but with a lot of things in common. And this is our new world. We live in different places, but we have common problems, and just by exchanging, we can find the best solutions from the best minds all over this blessed planet. So thank you very much to all of you, and let's have a clap to ourselves because we deserve it. And we are closing now this forum. See you in the next activity in our conference. So goodbye to everyone.
Bye-bye. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Thank you.
Ciao, ciao. Ciao, ciao, ciao. Yeah. Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Merci beaucoup. Bye-bye. Merci.
Thanks,
Sogo.
Stay safe.
All right. Bye-bye, Sam.
Have
the... Safe yourself.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Hugo.
Hi, Florence.